Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. As we gather on Palm Sunday, we gather hearing and rejoicing in our Lord's entry into Jerusalem. For he has come at the time of Passover, and people are flocking to him. However, this entry, we see something like this going on throughout history, and we see many ties to other cultures, other relations, and other places. One classic example of a triumphal entry goes, next slide please, goes to the Roman civilization, where they had in their history the idea of triumphal entries, where their rulers, their leaders, would go and after their great military campaigns, would have giant political days of entering back into their cities. For they held the idea that their Congress gave to their leaders the power that was vested in them, and shown with that staff that you see in the painting behind me. And now it was the giant festival showing off all the glory of what had been done. For the glory of Rome went the handing back of the staff that was given, went all of the pomp and circumstances of sacrifices being offered up, went the actual paying of their soldiers to actually show we actually did it. And this would go on and on and on, days upon days possibly, and if nothing else, at least one full day. And it was expected, and it was something that you tied in. And people would throw down leaves, and they would wear festival garments. And you would ask, well, why would they do this? And the answer was, for the Romans, this was propaganda. They knew it was propaganda. This was part of what they called their political life. As part of the life of a Roman, you were supposed to attend these things so that you can see the glory of Rome on display and say, truly, we are those that are blessed by the gods. Truly, we are those that Rome has looked favorably upon. And now look at all of the glorious things that are going on around us. And next slide, please. We can come to a similar expectation when we come to Jesus' entry. When we look at Jesus' entry, we can see that the crowds were loving it. They had seen Jesus and followed Jesus for quite some time. They had been going on seeing him raise Lazarus from the dead. They had seen all of his healings as they followed him around Galilee. People were flocking to him as he now goes to Jerusalem. And we hear about the gathering before this and the chapters before. And now he was about to enter the holy city. He was about to go there for Passover, one of the highest holy times to go and enter into Jerusalem. And now the one who is being lifted up and praised as the Son of David was about to enter in. And people were going absolutely crazy. They were cutting down branches, throwing them in the way, taking off their cloaks, and shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest, knowing that he is the one that has come to save them. But with all of these festivities, we could ask, what was their expectation? For they looked to see him as the one that would come and be the one to save them from the Romans, to save them from their enemies, being the physical captors that they had. However, we see Jesus having a very different expectation, for he comes not as one as a conqueror, but as one who is about to do the conquering. He comes entering into the city at the threshold of what we call Holy Week, the week where Jesus will go and do that conquering for all of life and all of salvation, where this triumph is one that he is already obtaining, but is now at the doorstep of obtaining it once and for all. For Jesus is about to cross a boundary here. He is about to cross a boundary at the point of no return. And it's not one that is often expected. It is not one that we actually look to. For he is entering in as the one leading the kingdom of God back into God's own city. He is the one that people were wanting and expecting. With their shouts and cries of Hosanna, calling, Lord, save us. But that salvation was not what we all hold to. Instead, he was going to be bringing them God's salvation and God's deliverance. A deliverance that would bring them to the doorsteps of his resurrection and that forgiveness and eternal life. But we're not quite there yet. So if we backtrack a bit and connect this into our Isaiah reading, we could see what Jesus is preparing for and how this triumphal entry truly does speak of God's triumph he's about to obtain. For next slide, please. For in that Isaiah reading, one that might seem a bit disconnected and obscure, we hear the prophecy of the suffering servant. This song in Isaiah is one that we hear of the one who will later on in Isaiah be the one that is scourged for all of our transgressions. We often know that suffering servant from the later chapter where we hear about what he does and who he is. But here in this Isaiah reading, the suffering servant is crying out with what the Lord has to say, crying out with what the Lord has tasked him to do. And this is exactly what we see Jesus doing as we look to his triumphal entry. For we look and we see with his in that first verse of our reading today that the suffering servant has been one who is tasked to speak. He is one that has come as the mouth of God, the one who is told to speak words of God's own authority. And brothers and sisters of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, this is exactly what we see him doing. This is what people were flocking to him for. And this is the words that we rejoice in. For the word that was made flesh has come and does speak these words. And the glorious news was that he does fulfill what Isaiah said and speaks words to those that were weary and heavy burden. Most of his words we hear in Luke and the other Gospels are to lift up those that are burdened down with their sins, that were weighed down with all they were tasked to do. And instead of giving them more, God lifts them up and takes that burden from them, offering up words from God that takes that away, offering up words that says you no longer have that burden, and that he speaks with that same authority, that authority that comes only from God and not from man. For what most people marked as they heard these words was that he speaks as no one else has ever spoken before, words that no one else could ever dare speak, because he was the only one with the authority to speak them. But not only does he speak, we hear in Isaiah that he comes with open ears. And open ears is a word, a phrase we don't often use too often, but is one that makes a lot of sense when you think about it. It's one that on the one hand means he listens. If you have opened ears, you're open to hear what is being said to you. For he hears what God has commanded and what God says needs to be done. And he listens. And he does it. For the second half of that phrase is open ears means not just hearing it, but accepting it. For open ears in Hebrew is a symbol of actually doing what you know and hear is right. And we hear that he is the one that is coming with open ears to save all those with closed and shut ears, coming to the stiff-necked Israelites who on this day are shouting out their cries of, Lord, save us, without really realizing what they're saying. For as they're crying out, Lord, save us, they don't even know what they're saying themselves. They look to him as one without even knowing what God is actually doing for them. Throughout his entire ministry, Jesus has been saying words that they don't understand. And Jesus has been saying, if you don't understand these things, how will you understand the greater things of God? And even his own disciples, the ones that have been following him around, don't understand his purpose and his tasks. Their ears have been shut, and they look to everything he says and does with pondering and confusion. They look to him and say, Lord, surely not, when he says what his task is. That when he hears from God that one that is pure and sinless needs to sacrifice himself for the sins of the world, they say no. Far be it, Lord. This cannot be so. And we hear him scolding his disciples, rebuking them, and calling this the works not of God, but of the devil. And more than that, we hear the words of our Lord with open ears coming to us with our closed ears, when we choose to rebuke and close our ears to what he has to say, when we think with our high and lofty thoughts that surely we know better than God at this point. We don't often say it in that same way, but we might find nicer ways to say it. For we might say, well, it was written way back then. They didn't know what they were saying back then. Or, well, God, you just didn't understand at this time. Or even worse yet, I just don't have the time, God, to hear your word. And we then drift away slowly from hearing and closing our ears more and more and more, to the point that we don't even hear God's word because we have shut our ears to even opening it in the first place. But sisters and brothers, like I said, this is what our Lord came to do. Our Lord came with ears that are open, and as Isaiah said, with a face that is like flint. For he is determined in what he is going to do. He knows what the Lord has said for him, and nothing is going to turn him back. Nothing is going to stop him for the task that is in front of him, to open your ears to the word of God and to bring eternal salvation and life. For we hear in Isaiah reading that he has come and will be the one that for all the strikes and all the ones that are striked against him, he will turn the other cheek. And this is the glorious news we see as he comes to his trials and tribulations, that nothing turns him back from saving you, from bringing you eternal salvation, and from bringing you that Hosanna that we desperately all need, whether we know it or not. And so, as we look to our Lord and Savior this day, and as we see him entering in with shouts of Hosanna and people crying out in the streets, we see that this is not a day of glory being given to God in the sense that they thought they were doing. This is not a sense where people were offering their praises and offering up their high and lofty words. Just as we gather here this day, it is not a day of our celebrating and lifting up high praises, but instead one where we praise our God for what does bring him glory. The glory of the one who was willing to go and face all that would oppress him this week just for your sake, to open your ears to his word, so that you could rejoice in that salvation that was offered to you, and that nothing could separate you from the love of God. And so we rejoice and give glory to God in the fact that glory is given when we see our need, when our hosannas tie into that gift that he has given to us, that what brings glory to God is hearing what he has done and accepting that with our entire heart, body, and being. Instead of closing our ears, it becomes opening them to hear what the Lord has done. Instead of closing our gates, we open them and see the threshold that the Lord has crossed, entering into his city to die for your sakes, that neither death nor life nor angels nor all the company of heaven could separate you from the love of God. In Jesus' name, amen.